today. They want to go down. I hear some pitter patter. That's pretty good. I was like, okay, looking out to see how many of you going down. If you guys going downstairs, how much money for a shipwreck? How much money would you pay for a shipwreck? Anybody? Yeah. How much money would you pay for a shipwreck? If you were going on what's the carnival trip? Like the carnival, what, a Caribbean trip on the Carnival? Is that what it is? A cruise ship, yeah, a big cruise ship, all right? So let's get that straight. Make sure you guys same page with I have. And so you pay money to go on it to see something, to stay afloat, correct? So anybody of you, if they said about halfway through we're going to have a shipwreck, so you're going to be paying for this, and anybody raise their hand and say they're going to go on that one? We don't know where it's going to happen. We're going to have a shipwreck. Anybody pay for that? Josh said, yeah, yeah, why not? And so that's what we want to talk about this morning is, you know, we, in our life, you don't know what your life is going to be like tomorrow. And I mean, a year from now, you could go, you can expect what you want your life to be like next year. But you don't know what your life's going to be like. And you don't know what you're going to face tomorrow or next month or next year. But you do know this, that when we put our faith and trust in Jesus Christ, his promises are true to form. And he's not after to shipwreck your life. He is there to help you through the storms. Do you believe that? What it happens is that we get sidetracked and we actually shipwreck our lives. When we do not follow Christ and when we do not put him first in our life, shipwreck is going to happen. And you're like, well, I didn't pay for this. I didn't put in for this. And in reality, what happens? A shipwreck happens. And then God is saying, look, I want to get you back to where you need to be. If you know Christ as your Savior, if you've put your faith and trust in him and you are not serving him today. Now listen to me. If you have put your faith and trust in Christ and you are not completely serving him 100% in your life, can I tell you this? That at some point in time, you are going to be in a shipwreck. And you're like, well, wait a second. This isn't what I came to Christ for. I came to Christ to change my life. Well, is that not true? Did he say he will change our life? But we have to let him change our life. I don't know how many times I have gone against God's will for my life. And God's will is this, that we're to love the Lord, your God, with all your what? Heart, your mind, not let other things cloud our mind, get into our life. And so when we put things that are not of God in there, it all starts to come and go where? It all starts to hit our heart. And with a heart, man goes what? Mankind goes to what they long for in their heart. And once it gets to your heart, wow, hold on. Because your shipwreck is going to change your life, or your shipwreck is going to take your life. And God wants to change your life. He doesn't even want you to get near the shipwreck. How many know, so when Paul was on his journey and he was in jail, he was in prison, and he's on his way to the island to serve out time. And what did he tell the people? What did he tell them? He said, hey, don't go just yet because there's a storm coming. I'm going to tell you foreknowledge of what God has told me that there's a shipwreck coming. And they're like, it's good. We've done this before. You don't know what you're talking about. And what happened? They got in a shipwreck. And then Paul says, hey, look, if you just stay true, they were going to kill all the prisoners. And he said what to them? Paul said, hey, don't kill us. God said everyone will be spared. Just ride through the storm. How many lives were changed because of that shipwreck? There was so many lives changed because of that shipwreck. So sometimes a shipwreck in our life comes because God is trying to help others to change. Paul, you say, Paul could have stood there and said, I don't deserve this, God. I've been following you. I've been doing the things that you want in my life. And then you're taking me into the shipwreck? Where's faith with Paul at this point in time? His faith is still in God. God is going to take care of him, right? Whether it's through the storm or he passes on into the kingdom of God. He's with God. So his faith is in God, but his faith is that God's glory is going to be shined and shown through who? Through him as he serves God. What I want to talk about today is not Paul's shipwreck. I want to talk about our shipwreck. I want to talk about a story back in 2 Chronicles chapter 20. So if you take your Bible and you want to turn there, go to 2 Chronicles chapter 20. We're going to start in 18. Now we'll get to 20. But I want us to realize that there are those that put their faith in God, and there are those that don't. And there are those that are around in your life that tell you, yeah, I believe in God. But do they really believe in God? There are those that have faith in the aspect of who God is, but they've never personally put their faith and trust in Jesus Christ. And so we're going to talk about that today. And so the title of this is How Much Money for a Shipwreck? How much would you pay to have a shipwreck? And the answer is this. When we get through this, the answer is this. You could be paying for your shipwreck by doing nothing in Jesus Christ. The shipwreck is going to come. And so we're going to learn from this story about a shipwreck. Let's read 2 Chronicles 18, 28, 34, and then we'll go to the Lord in prayer. So 2 Chronicles 18, 28 through 34. So the king of Israel and Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah, went up to Ramoth-Gilead, and the king of Israel said to Jehoshaphat, I will disguise myself and go into battle, but you wear your robes. And the king of Israel disguised himself, and they went into battle. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning. And Lord, we know that your word is powerful, and it's quick. And Lord, I pray that it would pierce our hearts and our minds this morning in a way that has never done before. Lord, help us to realize how much you love us, but help us to realize how much we should love you. So God, help us this morning. Do a work with your Holy Spirit as your word is put forth. In thy name we pray. Amen. So, anybody ever look at the horizon? Anybody ever look at, like you go onto a mountaintop, or you go set in your car aside and you pull over the side of the road and you just watch the sun rise or you watch the sun set? Anybody ever do that? You're on vacation or something and you're like, wow, that was fantastic. And you'll sit there, maybe you're at your campsite, or maybe you're somewhere and you're just like vast in the moment. And what is it that makes you want to do that? What is it that makes you want to be a part of that? Isn't it give you this satisfaction, this peace inside, that there's some peace that's in the world? And here's the truth of it, is we want to have the peace without going through the battle to have peace. And I'm gonna change this around. I'm gonna do it. Look at it this way. So when I look at it, I think, well, you know what, God? Why can't I just have my coffee in the morning? And can't I just be up there on a mountaintop watching the sun rise and the sunset? And you ever see clouds like change forms? And you have to be there like quite a few hours, right? And then you're watching it, and then you look again, and it's changed another way. Or then you have what is those clouds that it, because of the cold and the warm, and it just all of a sudden it comes, it's like choppy. You ever see that? And it's really cool. How about clouds that change light? Like you have all it goes to pink cotton, you know, like it looks like cotton candy up there, right? And it's just so peaceful. What are the colors? Violet, right? Pink. What's the other one? Orange. What's another one? Yellows. Occasionally those things. And then and it's all mixed in. It's just beautiful. Why wouldn't you? Anybody want to just stay there when that area? How many would like to just float there? Never come. Just be there. Drink coffee. And then here's the other part I got thinking about. What else would I want? Well, I have to eat. So what I would like is this. Go to an island that is beautiful, first off. Really nice island. We could grow crops. We could grow food. We could do whatever we want. I could. And so then I'm in my tower, the highest tower of what I could find, and then I'm able to see the sunset, sunrise, and as I'm there, it's about me. It's about what kind of coffee I have, and I don't have to get it. It's someone's getting it for me. It's about what kind of food is going to be served for me. And so then I'd say, hey, I want this on my menu for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. And then, oh, you know what? I'm going to take a stroll. So maybe about this time I'll come back. And I started thinking about all the things that I want for me in this life. That's the way I would want my life to live. It's just to sip on coffee or tea or a hot chocolate if you want that. Or, you know, a cold ice water, you know, when it's warm out. But here's the whole fact of it, is that if it's what I want, then I want my temperature to be the temperature that I feel comfortable in, right? Whether it's warm, cold, whatever. I change it, not those people that are serving me. And so in my life, what I want is that everyone serves me and I don't have to serve anybody else. And that's a great life to live, right? Right on. And so here's the fact of it, is we are so selfish in these areas that we expect someone else to bring that flavor of life into us. And can I tell you this? Christ has brought that flavor, but it doesn't come now. It comes to the kingdom that we will be going to. But what he wants from us now is this. He wants us to serve him. Because we love him. Well, why do we love him? Because he first loved us. And how do we show him that we love him? Well, we do the things that he wants us to do here on earth. So that when we know that the troubles are going to come, isn't it proper to say that in the Bible it says, hey, beware, because what's going to happen? Your life will have what? Troubles and trials. But how you handle it is that you give your life to Jesus Christ and you allow Jesus Christ to do the work in you. So that now you're changing it. So now it's about putting a person before you. So all the things that I said I wanted to put myself in this place, you know, to look over and have everybody wait on me. What did God do for me? He sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die for me so that one day I will be with him for all of eternity. And what? Pay taxes in heaven? No. Will gardens grow in heaven without me having to worry about planting, without me worrying about weeding? Maybe I'll plant, but I don't have to weed. Hallelujah, right? When we're praising God for what he has given us. There's no more Satan. There's no more temptation. He's taken all that away. And what is it that I give him is the time on earth right here. This vast, it's not the majority, it's the minority of my life, is what I have a chance to give him my love. Because he first loved me. I have a chance. I have a portion of my life to give back to my Lord and Savior. And what portion do I want to give? When you give of yourself to somebody else, is that out of love? I mean, you can do it. You can do it out of anger. You can do it out because you're told to. You know, but what's the proper way to do it? To put somebody else in that place where you want to be. That's the proper way. You understand what I'm saying? But we want it the other way around. We want to live our life and we want all the people to put into us. Where in reality, Christ put, he said, hey, I come to this earth and I came to this earth to give you and live as an example. To give you an example of how that we're supposed to what? Hate our enemies? No. Love our enemies. Take advantage of people? No. Give them. Not take advantage, but give to people. Love on people. If we have that love to give, it only comes from Jesus Christ. Because can I tell you what? I don't want to give out my portion. How many want to keep their love to themselves? I feel much better doing that. But when you come to know Christ and Christ does that work in you, he starts to change your view and he starts to say, hey, it's not about you, David. It's about others in your life. And whatever it takes to bring that person to me, I'm going to use you. Are you okay with that? What does it involve, God? It's always a question, isn't it? It's like, do I really have to do this to bring that? Hey, you might have to. When I went in the military, I hadn't a clue what I was going to get into. All I know is I was going to get a college education, going to put in my time because I felt, you know what? If others gave their life, I will give my portion of life, you know, go in for 3 years, 4 years, whatever it took, and then come back out. But once I signed that dotted line, whose was I? I was the government. And my whole life evolved around what they said I could, couldn't do. So, when you give your life to Jesus Christ, does Jesus Christ do that to you? Does he make you sign a document and say, you're mine? You don't sign any document. This is awesome. Christ signs your name in a book of life. You didn't sign it. He signs it. And when he signs it, it's for eternity. Did you catch that? And then what does he ask of you? Just to love me. Love the Lord your God with all your heart. He doesn't ask you to go to war. He doesn't ask you to do all the things that the government asks you to do. He doesn't ask you to pay taxes. He doesn't ask you, he just says, hey, do what is right. Pay Caesar what is Caesar. But give me what? Give me your whole heart. Give me your whole mind. Give me your whole being so that I can use you to bring glory to the future, which is the kingdom of God. And so when we do this, we are looking at Jesus as our guide, right? Jesus as our Savior. Jesus. And a lot of times we'll get up in the morning and we do what? Is he our guide? Do we go to him first or do we go to something else? Who becomes our guide in life? Who becomes the person who is taking us to the places that we need to go? Money, all the efforts that take place. And all I can tell you is this, is that the title of this is How Much Money for a Shipwreck. If we could pay, we could have so much money in this world. What's the ship that sailed out years ago? The Titanic? The biggest ship ever made at that point in time, right? And the wealthy got on it, yes? Yes, exactly. Man said, hey, this is unsinkable. We're going to put all this money into it. And how many of the wealthy went? All of them. Everybody on the ship was basically wealthy unless they were servants. And we know the story because we watched, right, the Titanic. And what happened to it? What happened to it? Exactly. And here's the thing, is in our life, as we're following Christ, as we're following God, we think that we're unsinkable. But the truth is, we're going to sink ourselves. Because we're thinking that we are unsinkable when we should know that we are what? We are sinkable. How many know that sin devastates your life? When Christ forgave you of your sin, he said, I will help you to take away the sin and the sin problems and help you get to this place that you want to be. But if we don't allow Christ in our life and put him first, then what happens? We become sinking ships. And so let's go into this part. And we're gonna have the example of two kings. One king is Ahab, the other king is Jehoshaphat. And so let's start right here where I left off. So the king of Israel and Jehoshaphat, verse 28. And the king of Judah went to Ramoth-Gilead, and the king of Israel said to Jehoshaphat, I will disguise myself and go into battle. But you wear robes. And the king of Israel, who is Ahab, disguised himself, and they went into battle. I want you to think about this. What are you disguising yourself with? See, Ahab, we know where Ahab was. How many know that Ahab did not really follow God? But he served for a nation that was supposed to serve God. But he didn't serve God. How many know that his wife Jezebel was thrown out of a tower, run over, and the dogs ate her bones and licked up the blood? How many know that, right? Now you do. So now here's Jehoshaphat, who is a king of Judah, and who is looking at all these things, and he's saying what? I need to put my faith and trust in who? God, who is the God of all of the universe, because I don't want things to happen like it happened with who? Ahab. And Ahab is disguising himself as who he needs to be, but he's not. He's not. How many of us disguise ourselves as believers in Jesus Christ? But we're not who we say we are. Because if we were who we say we were, then we would what? We would walk with him. Now listen, sin comes to us in different ways, does it not? And listen, one sin will affect you a way that it doesn't affect another person, but it's still sin, it's still the damage that can happen in your life. So that's why God says to pray one another, not what? Come after one another, right? But to pray one another, because what? One day, you're going to hit the sin that's going to affect you in the way that it affected another person. You understand that? It doesn't give us the right in Jesus Christ to sin, but it gives us the right to pray over our sin and pray that God helps us in that and Christ helps us. Christ says that he will transform us, right? But it's not going to happen if we're going, hey, I'm a believer. And Eric, you know, you shouldn't be doing this, do this, but in the meantime, we're doing what? We're disguising ourselves, and in reality, we're doing things that we shouldn't be doing. Well, nobody found out yet, right? And if they didn't find out, well, then I'm not caught. Hey, a shipwreck's coming. Yes? And we all know that that could take place at any point in time. We don't know when. We don't know when that's going to take place, but we're going to look here a little bit deeper into Ahab. And they went to battle. Now the king of Syria had commanded the captains of the chariots, fight with neither small nor great, but only with the king of Israel. So only with King Ahab. And as soon as the captains of the chariot saw Jehoshaphat, they said, it is the king of Israel. So they turned to fight against him. And Jehoshaphat cried out. Now listen, here's what we should be doing, is crying out to the Lord. Jehoshaphat saw that there was people coming in. How many know that there's trials and tribulations? You can be following God, and all of a sudden there's trials and tribulation, and it's coming at you like hounds on your heels. What are you going to do? How are you going to react? Well, you first need to do what? Cry out to who? Cry out to your wife, because she's going to help you. Cry out to your grandparents because they're going to help you. Cry out to your dad. Cry out to, there's so many people or so many things. Cry out to the government. They're going to help us. They're going to take us through all of everything that we need. No, it's cry out to who? Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Cry out to God because you are acknowledging that he is what? He is Lord of your life. You need help from a power that can't, that can sustain the world. That's who we need power from. And so Jehoshaphat comes and he says, hey, he says, I'm going to do this. So Jehoshaphat cries out to the Lord, and the Lord did what? Threw him under the chariot, ran him over 50 times. What does it say? God helped him. The Lord helped him. God drew them away from him. So as soon as the captains of the chariot saw that it was not the king of Israel, they turned back from pursuing him. But the certain man drew his bow in random and struck the king of Israel, which is Ahab, between the scale armor and a breastplate. I want us to get this part. So you can disguise yourself all you want to. You can put on whatever you want to. But the fact is you are still the person who God knows who you are. He knows who you are. He either knows you personally as Lord and Savior that you put your trust in him, or he doesn't know you all. Flip to Matthew real quick and come back to this. Go to Matthew chapter 7, 21 through 30 to 23. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. On that day, many will say to me, what? Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons and do many mighty works in your name? And then I declare to you what? I never... How many want that? How many want to stand before God and God say, look it, you did all these things. You put on this over here, this mask here, you put on this, and all these things that you disguised yourself as, but listen, the truth was, is you never put me in your life. You never accepted Christ. You never pleaded for his blood to cover your sins. And so depart from me, you workers of what? Of iniquity, sin. You just want to do whatever is pleasing in your sight. How many know that the world is this way? We can do what we want to because, hey, I didn't kill anybody. I didn't steal anything. If the law's not going to put me in jail, then I can do anything I really want to, and I can walk the line on this moral aspect. But the truth of the fact is as you know Jesus Christ, you can't run from God. You can't run from Christ because he knows you are his child, and you know that you are his child, whether you know him this much. But at least you know him. And the Bible says this, that there are many that come and say, hey, I sold my house and gave all my money. But they didn't know Christ. They gave all the money to a charity or gave all their money to a church or gave all their money. Hey, that has nothing to do with it. Their life became a shipwreck in a moment. Because they did not put their faith and trust in Jesus Christ. They did not declare Christ. And then he says, God says, I never knew you. And he says, depart from me, you workers of lawlessness or iniquity or sin. There is coming a day in that judgment. And that's what this is talking about. There's a coming day that the judgment seat is there. And every knee and every tongue will bow and they'll say, they'll confess that Lord is, how do you not when you're standing before God and Jesus is standing there and you're like, oh my word, everything is true of what this said. Everything is true. And then you're cast into the lake of fire with all the demons because the lake of fire was created for the demons, not for us. And because you choose to not follow God, and not put Christ in your life. He says, depart from me, I never knew you. So there is hope, and I want us to look at this. There is hope for us. I know what I wanted to get across to you is Ahab thought he was going to get away with it. Imagine this. So Ahab escaped. They put this plan together, and Jehoshaphat is to put on Ahab to dressed like the robes, you know, and so everybody will follow him because they're after Ahab. And so Ahab is cruising with his servant, his servants out there, you know, running the deal, and he goes like, imagine Ahab looking back and going, hell, we're finally out of range of bow. There's no way they're going to get me. I mean, it wasn't a tank. There was no air force at that time. It was archers and swords. And so he's long past. He's out of range. But who is in control? God is in control, and here's shipwreck coming from Ahab, and he's riding there, and he's looking. I could just see him going, we made it. They're going up to the mountain, you know, and getting away from Syrian army. And all of a sudden, the Bible says, some young guy drew back his bow. He went. And can you imagine the guys going? It's like, it's going. Oh, my word, it's going to hit. Who does it hit? Does it hit the servant? And tell me this. How accurate must this be placed if he is wearing armor? His front is covered in armor. His back is covered in armor. His head is covered in armor. And there's one place right here that is not covered. And the arrow comes from one guy shooting. And here it goes. And it goes right here and lays inside of him. Doesn't kill him right away. And the Bible says that the servant took him and put him up and lead him against the chariot, and he watched the battle for the rest of the evening. Here's what I want us to get from this. You will remember every chance that you had to accept Jesus Christ at the time that you'd pass on. If you didn't put your faith and trust in Christ, you have no hope. Can I tell you that? There is no hope. And you start wondering as you're laying there, am I good enough? Did I do this? What did I do? Did I do this? What's the value of my life? Can I make it? The answer is this. No, you can't. You cannot. It doesn't matter how many good works you do and fulfill. At the end of your life, what matters is if you put Jesus Christ first, foremost, in your heart. I didn't say that you didn't sin, because God knows that we are all what? Sinners. And that all of us are saved. If you accepted Christ as Savior, all of us are saved by what? Grace. Well, why do you need grace? And grace isn't somebody that's on TV. We don't need that type of grace. We need the grace that takes us where? Takes us to heaven, because it covers our sin. I am a sinner saved by grace. Hallelujah. So when I stand before God, I can't say, hey, you know what? I preached my heart out for how many years? And God goes, yeah. But you didn't accept my son. You didn't say that you were a sinner. You didn't accept my grace. You did all these things, but you didn't do it for me out of love for what I gave you. You tried to work for it. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9 says this, lest a man should boast, right? I can't boast of what I have done, because I have done nothing that I deserve heaven. How many of you know that? Oh, thanks a lot. No, we know that we don't deserve heaven because of our sin in our life. But we deserve heaven because of Christ's love for us. Amen? We don't deserve it. He's the one who went through all of the sacrifice of his body. He went through the torture and all these things to rectify myself. To take away my sins. That's why he redeemed me, because he loved me. So now, if I know that he loved me that much, now what do I want to do in return for him? Well, it should be what? Loving him. He knows we're not going to be perfect. He just wants us to love him. And to keep trying. And keep moving forward and keep trying. And here's the difference, is Jehoshaphat, he was not a good man. But he served the Lord most of his time. But we're going to find out in the end that he became shipwrecked. But I believe this, that we will see Jehoshaphat in heaven. I do believe that. He was imperfect, but God forgave his imperfection. Amen? How many of us are imperfect? But God is going to forgive your imperfections because of grace that is given to each one of us. We just have to accept it and believe it. So it says, so in verse, go back to 2 Chronicles, and let's read chapter 19. Let's go there. Verse 1, Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah, returned in safety to his house in Jerusalem. But Jehu, the son of Hanani, the seer, went out to meet him and said to King Jehoshaphat, "Should you help the wicked and love those who hate the Lord? Because of this, wrath has gone out against you from the Lord. Nevertheless, some good is found in who?" So, here's what I want us to get. Just some good was found in Jehoshaphat. How much good was found in Ahab? Nothing. None. And as Ahab is sitting there and watching the sun go down and his army being depleted, do you think that he is thinking of his life in a good way? Or do you think he's thinking about some regrets? I have to think of the latter. I think he's thinking about regrets. Christ is not about regrets. And listen to me, here's another part. So, like Paula, when I was talking to her, and she's like, I just haven't lived my life the way that I wanted to live it, but I know that Christ loved me, and I did the best I could. You know what? That's what I want to hear. We are all imperfect, but did we do our best that we could? Did we do our best? And we have here Jehoshaphat, who is saying what? He comes in, I love this part, he comes into his home, and what does he say? The Bible says he is safe. Anybody ever run from third to home? Anybody play baseball? You ever did it? Dave, so you did. So what does it feel like when you're running about halfway and you know that they're going to throw the ball? Exactly. And we're just like, oh man, and you're like going and going, and you're going, I don't know what happens, like all of a sudden you kick into this high energy gear, right? Afterburner, that's what it is, where you never ran that fast before, but you're like going, and then you're like, okay, I'm just gonna dive for it, and you never would dive this way, but all of a sudden you're like face first and you're getting all this there, and you hit the bag and you're like hoping, right? Because you don't know where the ball's coming, you don't even know if you were tagged. You just hit the base and you're going, man, I hope I made it, right? See, that's the thing that's going on in our minds, is we need to have that Christ, give me that power. I'm going home. I'm running. And it's not that you're stealing life. You're giving to life. You're moving with this. Hey, I'm going to put it on the board. I'm going to put a point on the board for my team, right? When we travel in this in life, and if we look at it, and I'm not trying to use baseball as heaven, but I'm looking at home plate. What does it feel like when you get home? And you weren't tagged out, right? You're tagged in. And everybody comes out of the dugout, and the applaud goes, everybody's up on the bleachers like, yeah, that was awesome. Some Christians hit a home run every time they get up to the plate. I don't like those Christians. But all I can tell you is God uses different believers in a different way for different people. I'm the one I'm moving from one base to the next. I walked. I had to go through getting hit, through here. That's me. I couldn't hit worth a lick. But the guy, the coach, he's looking at me, he's like, dude, you don't move. So I'm going to put you in front of the heavy hitter because you don't move. Like, if you can't hit it, you're not going to swing, which you're not going to strike out, but you don't move, you stay in there. And how many know that wild balls come? And I don't move. I got hit. So I got hit here. I got hit in the head. Maybe that's what's wrong with me. And then they hit here. All these, I got hit everywhere, but I always got on. And then I always say this. I just talk about this. Dominic Fortuna. So he just started. Miko's right down there, He probably doesn't remember me at all. But I remember him. He was the heavy hitter. The coach was like, Dominic, you're up. You know, and he would set that stance, and he'd do his deal, and pop. And I would run the bases and go. The whole thing is it's part of a team, right? It doesn't matter if I couldn't hit a home run, but it matters if he hit a home run. What does it matter? In the walk of following Christ, of doing the things that we're supposed to do for God, does it really matter how much you do? No, what matters is that you do it. That you love the Lord your God with all your heart. And God uses you. Listen, he uses you where you're at. He's not looking at you and going, how come you didn't do this today? And how come you didn't do that today? Listen, he just wants your love. He wants your attention. He wants you to do what he commanded us to do and live the way that we're supposed to, because he loved us first, and so we love him back. Amen? It's very simple, and that's the will of God. And Jehoshaphat was getting it, but he lost it in the end. And so let's go on. But he says, some good work is found in you. All I can say is I love that part, because when I look at my life, I can go, I know, God, you can find a little bit of good work in me. If I love you, you'll find some work. Amen? If we love God, we will do righteous things. But listen, it's not the good works that get us to heaven. Amen? It's our faith and trust in Jesus Christ. So let's go down to chapter 20. After this, the Moabites and the Ammonites, and with them some of the Meunites, came against Jehoshaphat for battle. So he won the victory. He came back. He had peace in his home. And now he's coming to this point where he's now facing another battle from beyond the sea, it says. And the part in the last part of chapter 19, it says this. You don't have to turn there, Nathan, but Ethan. It's deal courageously, and may the Lord be with the upright. Deal courageously. How many of us need to have that in our thought to be courageous? The battles that you face, don't you need to be courageous? And the Bible says to deal courageously with what? With what's going through your mind. If you don't take it serious, if you don't set up parameters in your life, then guess what? What's going to come in is the temptations of life. Amen? It will. So we must take parameters in Jesus Christ and take it seriously and do it, what does it say? Courageously. Like you're in a battle, right? So here they come. Here comes another war, and he has to decide, what am I going to do? Verse 3, then Jehoshaphat was afraid. How many of us would be afraid? How many are afraid of certain things that come in your life? I am too. It's normal. We all have things that come in our life, and fear comes and arises. Then Jehoshaphat was afraid, and he set his face to do what? Seek who? This is where we fail, is we don't seek the Lord first. And when we don't seek the Lord first, then how can he show us and help us through what we need to have? From all the cities of Judah, they came to seek the Lord. And this is the part that's really cool. He proclaimed a fast through all of Judah. And Judah assembled to do what? Not just him, but all Judah came together to seek the Lord. So now let's go to verse 12. It says, O our God, will you not execute judgment on them? For we are powerless against the great horde that is coming against us. How many realize that you are powerless against Satan? You are powerless against him unless you have Jesus Christ. But when you seek him, he says he will what? Not Satan. When you seek Christ, he says he will what? He will find you. He will be with you. A lot of times what we do is we do it the afterwards. Oh man, I got in trouble. And then we start to do what? Then we start to seek him. Wait, it's too late to do that. We need to seek him before the temptation. Yes? And so here it is. He says, so We are powerless against the great horde that is coming against us. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are upon national TV. They're going to tell us what to do. Matter of fact, they're even going to do a write-up tomorrow about us, and they're going to see that all these things took place and God was victorious because it's on national TV. Hey, that ain't happening. Just because it's on national TV doesn't mean it's so. There's so many lies that go on national TV. What truth is this. What is it that is inside you and me in our decision making? That's the truth, because you only know what decision you made for today and you made for your issue that you're going through, right? I am the only one that knows what decision I made. So nobody can put me on national TV and say that I did this when I'm disguising myself to do something that I know that I wasn't supposed to be doing. Does that make sense? The only one that can is Jesus Christ, and He knows, and God knows our heart. God knows our intention. And as we serve Him, He does great and mighty things. And so this is what takes place. He says, if you, man, take this to the bank. Because this is it, right here. Verse 13. Meanwhile, all Judah stood before the Lord with their dogs, with their cats, with their flowers, with their food. What does it say? All Judah stood before the Lord with their... Come on. Wives and children. What? You want to take a stand in life? You do it before God and you take your children and your wife with you. You want to be a man of God? You stand with your children and show them who is the one that's going to take us through. You want to be a woman of God? You take your children, you take your grandchildren, you take children in your life, you show them who is God. This is not an act of hiding of who God is. This is an act of showing who God is. Are you with me? This is a part where you're not going, man, I don't know if God is with us. It's a part of going, we're with God. God is with us. And what does the Bible say? If God is with us, then who can be against us? And who is against you? It's not your neighbor, can I tell you? It's not your husband. It's not your spouse. It's not your children. It's not the government. Who is against you? Satan is against you. He is forming things and he is doing a work against you, and you need God Almighty to stand up for you. And in doing so, when we have our faith in that area, we are standing with who? You're standing with somebody. And you go, well, my child doesn't understand. Can I tell you this? They understand more than what you think. Imagine if you grabbed your little child and you sat down and you said, hey, we're going to pray to God over this situation that's taking place in my life. We're going to pray over the situation that's taking place in your life. We're going to pray over the situation that's taking place in all of our family's lives. And you start praying with your children. You start praying with your spouse. You start praying with your parents. Can I tell you, that changes. We learned last week that God is going and searching to and fro on those who are what? Those who are after Him. Those who are wanting Him to come into their home. You don't have to be perfect. Amen? You don't have to be perfect. You just have to love the Lord. And so here's Jehoshaphat. He is like, I'm loving God for the people. I'm loving God for my family. That's Jehoshaphat. And here's God. God responds in this. in verse 14, and the Spirit of the Lord came upon Jehaziel, the son of Zechariah, son of Benaiah, son of Jeel, son of Matani, a Levite of the sons of Asaph, in the midst of the assembly. And here's I believe that they put these names in because it's a generation thing. A generational name. He served God. He served God. He served God. He served God. Now, we're giving a word through, not through the ones that served generations before, but guess what? We're giving a word from your child, your grandchild, your great-great-great-great-grandchild. Is that not awesome? That your life can matter in the future of your children and your grandchildren? That's how God works. And he said, listen, all Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem, the king Jehoshaphat thus says to the Lord, to you, do not be afraid. I love that. I love that. He's telling them, do not be afraid. Right? God's saying, do not be afraid. Now, how many times do we fear? And do not be dismayed at this great horde or what is taking place, because what? The battle is yours, and you're all alone. No, the battle is not yours. It is whose? It is God's. And tomorrow go down against them. Wait a second. God, I'm not going to go down. I just prayed to you to take it over. That's all I did. I don't want to do any more service. I just want to sit up in my, you know, and have my coffee and sip on tea and let you take care of everything. God said to go down, meaning you have to put your faith to action. How many know that? We have to. You don't just tell me that you love me. You show that you love me, right? We shouldn't just tell our children we love them. We should show them how we love them, right? Same with our spouses. Same with these things that take place. So let's go on. Tomorrow, verse 16, tomorrow go down against them. Behold, they will come up by the ascent of Ziz. You will find them at the end of the valley, east of the wilderness of Jeruel. You will not need to fight in this battle. Did you hear that? You will not need to fight in this battle. But I just had to go. I just had to have faith. Isn't that amazing? The battle belongs to who? And I don't care what you're going through. Listen, that battle belongs to Jesus Christ. You just need to love him and serve him and stay continuing in serving him, because the battle is his. He is not going to take you and put you in a shipwreck unless he's going to save your life in the shipwreck. You follow? The shipwreck might be for somebody else, not for you. It says, stand firm, hold your position, and see the salvation of the Lord on your behalf. Oh, Judah and Jerusalem, don't be afraid and do not be dismayed. Tomorrow go out against them. The Lord will be with you. So when they go and they're down there and they see them all coming, I mean, imagine this. I mean, imagine going down and you know that God said you don't have to fight, but what if I do? How many know that we are fickle people? And so you're going down and you see them and you see them, they're all ready for war. And you're like, are you sure, God, that you're not going to be fighting for? You know, I hope you're going to be fighting for us. Listen, don't hope. Know in the hope. When you are in love with Jesus, can I tell you this? Oh, wow, that was a good one. When you're in love with Jesus, when you're in love with him, what happens to the things that are going on in your life? Do you worry about those things? You tend to forget about those things. And you just drive forward. And you're telling your children, you're telling the people that are around, you're like, just keep your eyes on who? Keep your eyes on the Lord. Don't look to me. Keep your eyes on the Lord, right? Keep your eyes on the Lord. And it continues on. And this is what Jehoshaphat is doing. He says, listen, give thanks to the Lord. Verse 21. He told the people, he says, give thanks to the Lord with steadfast love that endures forevermore. Wait. We're going to give thanks in the troubles, Yes. Yes. We're going to give thanks to God for the troubles, because guess what happens? When you get through the troubles, do you know how much stronger your faith is? So you give thanks for it. It's so much easier to go through something when you give thanks, right? Now, some food I've had, and I've given thanks, and can I tell you what? It doesn't change the taste no matter what. But in life with people, it's different. When you're serving God, you're loving somebody. You're not tasting them. You're not gnawing on them. Thank goodness. You're experiencing them through the love of God. Amen. We are to serve one another in Jesus Christ, and we are to serve God so that we give thanks to Him for all the things that He has given to us. Verse 24, when Judah came to the watchtower of the wilderness, they looked toward the horde, and behold, there were dead bodies on the ground. None had escaped. I'm not going to read through the whole thing, but I'm just going to tell you in short. They were there, they were praising God, and it soon... Listen, this is the part I want you to get. When they began to sing and praise, in verse 22, when they began to sing and praise, it's a mindset. It's a mindset. The Lord set an ambush against the men of Ammon, Moab, Mount Seir, who had come against Judah, so that they were routed. For the men of Ammon and Moab rose against the inhabitants of Mount Seir, devoted them to destruction. And when they had made an end of the inhabitants of Seir, they all helped to destroy one another. They didn't have to lift a hand, but God was in the midst of it, was He not? And they got to the watchtower. They're looking at the watchtower. They stand up there. They had hope in Jesus Christ. And the time came when they looked over all the things that was going on. They gave praise and worship. And then they stood in this position where they were seeing God that already did it. Whose battle is it? His. Do you think they were glad they put their hope in Jesus? Their hope in God? I do. I know they were glad. Now we're going to jump all the way to the end of the chapter. And we're going to learn what Jehoshaphat, who is imperfect, and then he does something that he shouldn't have done. Verse 35 of chapter 20, it says, and after this, Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, joined with Ahaziah, king of Israel, who acted wickedly. When you join with somebody who's doing active wickedness, how many know that we can do that? We can find somebody who's doing wrong. Because sometimes it's easier to go with that crowd than it is to go with the crowd that's staying righteous, right? And so this is Jehoshaphat, and he goes with the wrong crowd. And then they started to build ships. And when they started to build the ships, and then the last part of this chapter says, because you have joined with Ahaziah, the Lord will destroy what you have made. And the ships were wrecked and were not able to go to Tarshish. And then 21 ends his life. Jehoshaphat slept with his fathers, was buried with his fathers in the city of David. Listen, verse 2, he had brothers and sons, and we're not going to name all of them. And all these were the sons of Jehoshaphat, king of Israel. Listen, what are you giving your children? Listen, what are you giving? What are you trying to give your children? Their father gave them great gifts of silver, gold, and valuable possessions, together with fortified cities in Judah, but he gave the kingdom to Jehoram because he was the firstborn. There's nothing wrong with your children getting certain things that are handed down, but what's wrong is this. Is if you're giving your children and thinking that wealth, fame, all the things of life is what you want to give them, it's the wrong answer. You need to give them God and let God give them the gifts. You follow? What is most important is your life. Your life, it can be a gift to your children on how you live your life for God. Because your children will look at your life and they will see it. How many of you know of great-great-grandpa or whatever, you know, grandma who lived their life and you're still not doing things because of their life? It's because of a life that was lived for God. And how many of us want that instead of this? Jehoshaphat gave his sons money, wealth, fame. And one son was put in that position and killed all his brothers. And then he reigned for 7 years, and God took his life because he was evil and he walked in Ahab's ways. Here it is, laid all out. Where are you at today? Where do you want to be? Where do you see yourself at tomorrow or next month? Can I tell you this? When you concentrate on Jesus Christ and you concentrate on the things that you're to do in Him, then if it is a shipwreck, listen, if it is a shipwreck, it's not that He's destroying your life. He is going to help you in your life so that you can help other people. Do you hear me on that? But if you are not following God, can I tell you what? Your life will end up in a shipwreck, and it will not be good. You will not have peace. It will not end well. So what I'm telling you is this. Every battle belongs to who? So why not give it to Him? You can't control your battle. How many of you are going to step out and go to war and tell everybody you're controlling it? Anybody? You can. It's the same thing with God. You can tell God all you want to, that I don't want to go through that. I don't need that. But can I tell you this? He's either going to use you to glorify Him, or He's going to use you to get you back to Him. So why not give Him the battle? You understand? Why not give Him your battle now? Because the battle belongs to the Lord. Say it with me. Say this. My battle belongs to the Lord. Let's do this together and stand. My battle belongs to the Lord. And let's live in that. Amen? Let's stand and sing.